Welcome teachers to this presentation on chemistry of processed foods. This is to make you aware about the processed foods that we consume regularly. In fact, we as chemists can understand a lot about foods, but somehow we don't pay as much attention. It is said that 70% of cancers like stomach cancer, kidney cancer, breast cancer, colorectal and endometrial are preventable if we eat right, maintain healthy weight, and have a regular physical exercise. And one important component, as you can see here, is eat right. And maybe what I'm going to talk about will focus somewhat on this, because some things may be in our control and some may not be in our control. So when we say eat right, we are having food regularly. What is the food? Any substances that can be metabolized by the body to give energy and build tissues. Why do we need foods? Because we need to maintain a healthy body and for our growth. And therefore, the foods must contain all the elements needed to maintain a healthy body. And these elements are present in the foods as essential nutrients. What are the nutrients? Can be divided into two parts, macronutrients and micronutrients. The macronutrients, which we consume in large amount and we need in large amount, are the carbohydrates, proteins, and fats are oils. And micronutrients are all the metal ions which are present in the body required for various functions and the vitamins. So the name obviously macro because we need in large amounts and micro because we need in much smaller amount. Now foods, they're generally classified, can be classified as per their origin, whether they are of vegetable origin or animal origin, by their chemical composition, as we just saw, or by their function, bodybuilding foods, energy-giving foods, and protected foods. What is a processed food? A food that has been altered from its raw state is the processed food. And this alteration can be done by cooking, drying, grinding, canning, pasteurization, heating, irradiating. It can also be done by adding ingredients for better texture, taste, for preservation, to look better, color, or to give it a different shape, emulsifiers, and so on. Why are most foods processed? Because we have to increase their digestibility. Many of them are not digestible as such. For example, wheat. We cannot eat wheat as such. We have to grind it. So this also is processing. We can't eat all vegetables as it is, maybe potato. We have to boil it or fry it. So to increase digestibility, to improve their nutritive and health value, to attract the consumers and to develop the food market, to preserve foods, to extend their shelf life, to maintain or enhance their quality, to maintain sensory properties, to make it more convenient, and undoubtedly also to destroy toxins or microbes, etc., which may be present. Foods are of three types: completely unprocessed, moderately processed, and heavily processed. Completely unprocessed in natural form without any additive. For example, a banana from a tree. Well, one can say egg directly from a chicken, but we will talk about even egg directly from a chicken, yes, may have additives, which could be intentional or unintentional. So we could have maybe some fruits or raw vegetables, but then sometimes we know that they may be carrying some pesticides. So which may be unintentional. And then we come to moderately processed foods, raw foods which have been changed, like whole grains to bread, chapati, cereal, pasta, crackers, potatoes or sweet potatoes into French fries and into different shapes. And among the most, discussed to be avoided, the highly processed foods, which have many ingredients which have been added, or many additives have been added, which could be pre-cooked or otherwise prepared, like cookies, snacks, bar, cakes, energy bars, candy, cooked foods, packed foods, and so on. As a general rule, minimally processed foods are healthier. Minimally processed. We know that we cannot do without processed foods, but minimally processing should be the case. In processed foods, the food additives are three types. As intentional, incidental, and indirect. Intentional are the ones which are added with a purpose. As we said earlier, for various purposes like restoration, enrichment, fortification, preservation, safety, for enhanced appearance, flavor, and texture of the product. Incidental, a substance that comes in contact with food during growth, like antibiotics, pesticides, as you said, pesticides in vegetables or fruits. Antibiotics, which is becoming a major concern now, be it eggs or meat products or dairy products, this is becoming a major concern. So these are incidental. They are not given directly, but they are indirectly transferred to the food that we eat. And then they are indirect. Indirect, something present in the food package, which will then be transferred to the food. You know that some of the food packages made of plastic, food is given. And plastic contains a lot of plasticizers. And if we store fatty food in them, the plasticizers get transferred to the fat. And therefore, it is indirect, but comes into food. That's why it is advised that never store pickles in plastic jars. Have it in porcelain or glass jars. Because many plasticizers which are used in plastics are carcinogenic. Now, what are the different kinds of intentional food additives? As I said, intentional. Some are intentional, incidental, like antibiotics and pesticide. But most important class, which concerns us all, are the intentional food additives. Now, let's look at different classes of food additives. And you will be surprised to know how many different classes are there. Acids, food acids, which make the flavor sharper and may also act as preservatives and may act as also antioxidants like vinegar, citric acid, tartaric acid, malic acid, fumaric acid, like, and so on. There are plenty, many others. Then there are acidity regulators, which are used to change or otherwise control the acidity and alkalinity of the foods. That is, the acidity should be regulated. Anti-caking agent, again an area of concern. These are added to milk powder, these are added to salt, these are added to powders, various kinds of powders. Anti-foaming agents, again added to foods like cooking oils. Antimicrobial agents like salt, sugar, nitrates, nitrites. Antioxidants such as vitamin C, which act as preservatives also by inhibiting the effect of oxygen of food, BHA, BHT, vitamin E, and so on. Bleaching agents to give better color or texture, like peroxides. Bulking agents such as starch to increase the bulk of the food without affecting the nutritional value. Well, its nutritional value will not be affected, we say, but then you may be adding a lot of starch. Food coloring to give it a better color. And what kind of colors are added? To anybody's imagination. emulsifiers, which allow the water and oils to remain mixed together in an emulsion. For example, in mayonnaise, which has become so popular nowadays. Ice cream, homogenized milk. I mean, one of the brand of, for example, ice creams, if you buy, which is a very popular brand, please make it a habit to look at the ingredients. It writes about 10 to 20% oil. It's very clearly written. The ice cream contains 10 to 20% of oil. Very popular brand. Then there are flavors which are added to give a particular taste or smell, which may be derived from natural ingredients or created artificially. Then there are flavor enhancers. Again, an area of big concern, like MSG, monosodium glutamate. They may be extracted from natural sources or created artificially. Flour treatment agents. These are added to flour to make cakes and improve its texture, and it helps in baking, these treatment agents. Glazing agents, which provide a shiny appearance, are also provide protective coating to the foods. Like glaze, as far as protective coating is concerned, even, you know, some of the apples that you buy, if you scratch them with a knife, you'll see a solid comes off it. So even the apples that we buy, which look highly shiny, you need to slowly, carefully, you know, just scratch with a knife, you'll find there's a solid coating on this. Humectants, which prevent foods from drying out. Pressure gases, which allow for package integrity testing to prevent foods from being exposed to atmosphere and, you know, granting its shelf life. Preservatives, you all understand the reason. Preservative prevent or inhibit spoilage of food due to fungi, bacteria, or other microorganisms. Stabilizers, thickeners and gelling agents like agar, pectin, these are used in jams, give foods a firmer texture. And like agar and pectin, they are also added to ice creams. While they are not true emulsifiers, stabilizers, not emulsifiers, they help to stabilize emulsion. So we add emulsifier and then we add a stabilizer to stabilize this. Then there are sweeteners, which are added to food for flavoring. Sweeteners other than sugar are added to keep the food energy calories low. Now, sometimes, therefore, they may carry artificial sweeteners as well. Thickeners are substances which, when added to the mixture, increases viscosity without substantially modifying its other properties. So with this, we saw so many additives are possible, and depending on food, not that all are added to all the foods that we buy, but depending on the food, various additives are added. And do we know what harm they are creating in the long term? Of course, what is added is always written within prescribed limit. But if you are consuming too much of those materials, one does not know how long or when they could create problem. And that's why it is never possible to pinpoint why various diseases come up. What are the health implications, obviously, of processed foods? Like, there is excess of salt, fat and sugar. It may result into gluten sensitivity, food coloring sensitivity. Some people are allergic to many foods. Reaction of additives, presence of pesticide, herbicide, and antibiotics, which will lead to their dependence. And these are some of the causes of disease. Now let's talk about some examples. Just due to limited time, I'll just pick up some of the common foods. So whether we are buying a completely processed food, or we are buying raw materials, they contain additives. We understand that it's not possible for us to make our own raw materials and process them. We have to depend on the market. So we may have limitations, but we are all as chemists intelligent enough to at least see what we are buying. Please make it a habit, because all the foods which are sold, branded foods, they have to write the ingredients. Please look at the ingredients and you will understand. So I'm going to show you some of the examples here, and to start with the first one, trans fats. Trans fat, what is a trans fat? It's a trans fatty acid, which is present in cooking oils, which may be present. It's not present in all cooking oils. But when you heat the oil repeatedly, some trans fats are generated. And these trans fats are not good for our health. In fact, Fasai has recommended the presence of TFA up to 10% or less, where the WHO says that it should not be more than 1% of our daily energy requirement. So the level set by Indian food administrators is much, much higher. The, as I said, trans fats can be generated by during processing of oils. So some of the oils may contain trans fats. During hydrogenation, there is isomerization, because we know that the natural cooking oils, they have double bonds present in them. And these double bonds are all cis. The natural oils contain different fatty acids which have cis double bond. So during processing or repeated heating, they can get converted into trans, and these are not good. And various issues have been related to these trans fat, like obesity, heart disease, diabetes, infertility, depression. Some of the common ones like low fat butter, margarine, in fact, may be loaded with TFA, so please look for it. Rusk, popcorn, we know Act 2 is very good, very easy to buy in the market, and you keep in microwave and you can make good popcorn. But look at the trans fat present on this. Instant soups. Yes, if you buy those, you know, instant soups like Ching, Sabnor, please look whether they have trans fat present on them. We look at some of these. Mahakosh, I have especially mentioned this, you know, Mahakosh refined oil, refined soybean oil, because it contains 1 to 2% of trans fat. Why I am pinpointing this here? Because one of the popular heroines of previous years, she is advertising nowadays at the ad. I have seen the ad coming at night. She's advertising for this, and her husband is an American doctor. So you all know, okay, whom I'm talking about. She's advertising about this oil. Do you think anybody will be consuming oils which contain trans fat? In fact, since that I saw the advertisement, I went and checked, and I found in the packet that it contains trans fat. We should not be therefore burned or be carried away by big advertisements, but take our own decisions. Maggi, so popular, so good, so easy. If nothing else is available, we feel so comfortable and enjoy. But you all know that 2 years back, the Maggi was banned. Why was it banned? It was banned because of sodium glutamate, commonly known as Ajinomoto. And all the Chinese food that we consume, they add Ajinomoto. And it's nothing but sodium glutamate. It was banned for this. But of course, later it was revoked. And why? Because sodium glutamate is not good. See, sodium glutamate is a flavor enhancer. It's added not only to Maggi or Chinese food, in many other foods, MSG is added. Therefore, some products, they clearly write, you, for example, Knorr products, when you some of these buy, they write no MSG added. So the MSG, it is used to enhance the flavor, as you can see here. Is used to enhance the flavor, and MSG makes the meat taste meatier, you know, and this means less meat is required to make a burger, and the product costs less. But is it necessary? Why do we add? And what are the disadvantages? Yes, disadvantages means It has various side effects which have been reported, like headache, flushing, sweating, nausea, muscles, weakness, etc. This could be because glutamate is an important chemical messenger in the brain. I'll come to its mechanism. But another, you know, chemical we many people use are the artificial sweeteners like aspartame. Aspartame is nothing but a dipeptide made of aspartic acid, that is aspartate, and phenylalanine. In fact, it was an accidental discovery because it was being tested as an anti-ulcer drug, and they found no, it is quite sweet. And of course, it could not become a popular anti-ulcer drug, but it became a sweetener. Both glutamate and aspartate are, you know, that they are acidic amino acids. Both contain additional acidic group, the acidic amino acids. And how do they act? Aspartate and glutamate act as neurotransmitters in the brain by facilitating the transmission of information from neuron to neuron. Too much aspartate or glutamate in the brain kills certain neurons by allowing the influx of too much calcium into the cells. This influx triggers excessive amounts of free radicals, which kill the cells. The neural cell damage that can be caused by excessive aspartate and glutamate is why they are referred to as excitotoxins. They excite or stimulate the neural cells to death. So excess use is what one has to avoid. We should not become, using some of these foods excessively and become dependent on these. Cooking oils. Most of the cooking oils, they all contain antioxidants. These numbers represent the names of compounds. You can easily get the names from the Google. As I said, they also contain anti-foaming agents. And some of these anti-foaming agents are nothing but silicon polymers, siloxanes. Then they contain stabilizers. And some of the oils are sold with added vitamins to the fortification. Free flow and anti-caking agents in salts. We prefer, you know, the salt, the namak that we buy should be free flow. But have you ever thought of how does it become free flow? Means they are adding something to absorb the moisture. Maybe they are adding sodium sulfate. And imagine if they are adding sodium sulfate to absorb water to make it free flow, the amount of sodium present in sodium in this salt is much higher than the pure salt. And when people say that you should consume less salt, in fact, we may be using more. So they are adding compounds to make it free flow, then they are adding anti-caking agents and a variety of anti-caking agents so that it does not become a lump. It does not join together. And the anti-caking agents like magnesium stearate, these are new agents. More often, they also use calcium silicate as anti-caking agent. Honey, we all would like to have honey, but now this is a case of an indirect transfer. There it was a case of, we talked of some cases of earlier intentional edits. Oh, here is a list of antibiotics honey from different sources in which 5 different antibiotics may be found, or 4 or 3 or 1 or 2. And some of them have 3, some of them have 4, some of them have 2, some of them have even 5. And only one honey, it was reported, did not have any antibiotic. This is data collected. Now, where from these antibiotics come? This antibiotic come from bee colonies. Because bee colonies are, you know, sprayed with antibiotics so as to increase their lifespan, and they produce more honey. But this antibiotics get transferred to the honey that we buy. And maybe then if we consume too much, everybody says take honey. Yes, it's good. But what if you're taking too much and we'll become inactive towards antibiotics? Yes, antibiotics, serious concern, not only honey. What about animal sources like milk, chicken, meat, milk, cheese. You know, because antibiotics are fed to even the added to the foods, to the hen, so that they don't become sick. And because when they lay eggs, some of them indirectly get transferred. That's why nowadays in the market they are advertising eggs without antibiotics, or antibiotic free eggs. Similarly, milk, nowadays some companies are selling, they write very clearly, milk no antibiotics. That means the common milk which is being sold contains antibiotics. Chicken, as I said, yes, it is added to their feed, you know, and when we eat that, this may be transferred to us and we may become antibiotic resistant, and no doubt antibiotic resistance is increasing, and this could be one of the reasons for the same. Again, I think a detailed study even in India, you know, has been done on this, that chicken and eggs may be making you resistant to antibiotics. Detailed study has been done. Yes, even you know, the poultry service, they reported, yes, these antibiotics are present, but this is the level and this is the permitted level. You know, in India, what it means, permitted level, how they have tested and how they would have worked, one doesn't know. But no doubt they have admitted, yes, that these different antibiotics are being used by the poultry association. It's been admitted. Additives in flour. See, the flour that we buy normal, of course, we cannot be grinding at home, not possible. They are whitening agents. And among whitening agents, what do they use? Peroxides. The anti-caking agents, as you said, in case of salt, they're also adding stabilizers. And among the whiteners, they're adding bromates. And you should know that only 2 years back, again, I'm saying, use of sodium bromate in breads was stopped 2 years back. Why did they stop 2 years back sodium bromate? Because they said it's a carcinogenic. That means so far what we have been consuming, it may not have been advisable. But how do we know now that people have completely stopped it? Maybe from sodium bromate, they may have shifted to potassium bromate. How do we know? What are its advantages and disadvantages? So all this contain additives. Just to give you an example again from a website. So nowadays, they also advertise that bread. If you take bread, you know, and people are very happy that, yes, people say that we are taking 100% whole wheat bread, you know, and they advertise that if you take two slices of bread, they equal to you know, a chapati. But have you ever thought of, when they write 100% whole wheat bread, does it contain 100% wheat? Please look at the ingredients written. If you look at the ingredients, on they will write whole wheat is only 50%. What is the rest 50%? All this. Gluten, yeast, cellulose, modified wheat starch, sugar, wheat bran, salt, molasses, calcium propionate, preservative, datum, sugar stearate. You can see all these. And these constitute rest of 50%. Now compare this to making, you know, chapati. Some people think, you know, why we should be having more parathas all the time. If you, I don't think you will add so many additives even if you are making parathas. And look at other breads. What is the browning agent they are adding? When we buy brown bread, they are simply caramelizing or adding some browning agent. So please make it a habit to look at the ingredients of the foods that we buy. We quickly sum up as sulfites. These cause migraines. These are also present in many foods, especially in, they are also present in alcoholic foods, and also pre-packaged foods and dry foods. So all processed foods, they contain a large number of additives, and we can talk of number of examples, but due to limited time, I only request you, you're all intelligent enough and you buy foods, make it a habit to So please look at the ingredients and make yourself aware. And therefore, the nutritional advice, you're all intelligent enough that we should eat a balanced diet. We should minimize white foods. We should maximize colored foods. Add veggies. Do not become dependent on it. It doesn't mean that we should stop. I mean, we can stop, you know. Of course, we're all driven to good foods outside. We go out, we eat, we buy packaged foods also. But even if you buy, for example, I'll just show you one example here of this, you know, Chinks. If you buy Chinks, soups, anything, if you look at the ingredients at the back, in the anti-caking agent, it has written silicon dioxide, anti-caking agent. And you all know what is silicon dioxide. So if you, you know, it is easy, very easy to prepare a soup of this. To boil, add, you know, they say, add 1 cup, take boiled water and add, and it's ready. But look at the long-term effect it may be having. Even the chips that you may buy, Lays, look at the back. It does write presence of trans fat. So what I'm saying is, this is my personal. Yes, have everything, but have in controlled amount. Thank you for your patience, and do fasting, but fasting does not mean ... Thanks. If you have any questions, you can call me at 98106, or you can write to me at gmprana1@yahoo.co.in. Thank you.